Good evening. My name is Scott Graw. I'm an associate dean in the College of Business, and it's my pleasure to welcome you guys here for what promises to be an exciting evening. Tonight's lecture is sponsored by the College of Business, along with the Murray Bacon Center for Business Ethics. Other sponsors include Green Umbrella and the Committee on Lectures, which is funded by the student government. Before I introduce our guest, I'd like to take just a moment and talk to you a little bit about the Murray Center for Business Ethics. Established in 1993, the center helps Iowa State students and Iowa firms understand ethical business dilemmas, both present and future. Activities of the center have included executive training, research projects, and a lecture series. It is named after the late Murray Bacon, a computer executive in Des Moines, who was generous enough to donate to the College of Business so that we can help organizations and businesses understand and teach business ethics to students. The Murray Bacon Center for Ethics is on the rise. At the College of Business, we look forward to offering more programs like this. Tonight, I am honored and privileged to have the opportunity to introduce our guest. Rick Ridgeway is Vice President for Public Engagement at Patagonia, a maker of high-performance outerwear whose mission is to protect and preserve the environment is at the core of its business operations. This year, Patagonia pledged to donate every cent of its Black Friday sales, $10 million, to grassroots environmental organizations. Mr. Ridgeway, one of the world's foremost mountaineers, has held numerous leadership roles at Patagonia during his long history with the company. He is responsible for many of its key environmental initiatives, including Footprint Chronicles, designed to bring transparency to the supply chain, Wornwear, which encourages reduced consumption through its repair and recycle program, and the Responsible Economy Campaign. Please join me in welcoming Rick Ridgeway.
Thank you, Scott, for the introduction. You know, I want to start by just saying that Iowa State rocks. And I was out in your state not too long ago, and I must say, on both my visits, the hospitality has just been fantastic, and you guys are becoming my favorite state in the union. Well, thank you so much for this invitation to speak to you today and share the sustainability and environmental commitments of Patagonia. I think, as most of you know, and as Scott just introduced, we're in the business of making outdoor apparel. It's important to start off explaining that we're still private. We're still owned by the founder of the company, Yvon Chouinard, who's the guy with the hammer, and he still comes in the office every day every day that he's not out surfing and fishing, so he doesn't actually come in that much anymore. But he started out as a blacksmith making pitons and carabiners, hammers, and hardware for mountain climbers. He opened a blacksmith shop in Ventura, California, where we're still headquartered, and he located it there for the very sound business reason that it was really close to a super good surf break. And then he also hired his friends in the beginning that were referred to appreciatively, and I might even say today reverentially, as dirt bags, a really accurate description. And by the early 70s, Yvonne and the dirt bag buddies expanded the product line to a few items of clothing for climbers, shirts and pants and shorts. And they were made, really importantly, they were made with the same dedication to quality and durability as the climbing hardware. And in fact, back in those days, in the beginning, we called the company Patagonia Software to make it as opposed to the hardware side of the business, but we had to drop that name when this guy up in Seattle named Bill Gates started using it to describe his products. But the clothes were still designed by dirtbags and worn and made for dirtbags. And that became our founding culture. In a lot of ways, it still is. And we captured that culture in the early photographs that we ran in our catalogs, where we really tried hard not to take ourselves too seriously. We really avoided hiring pro athletes, and instead we used photographs of, you know, the more lunatic fringe of our sport, and we did everything we could to avoid a macho look. And in fact, we wanted to show that our gear was as much for women as it was for men, so we ran photographs in those catalogs of what it's really like to be a mom in a world where everything doesn't always go perfectly. So we love photographs like this one that came in from our customers, and photographs that were definitely today what we would all call politically incorrect, like way incorrect. This is the most notorious one we ever published, and it ran almost 30 years ago, and we got thousands and thousands of letters. And in fact, just recently, I Googled Patagonia baby toss, and I got 175,000 hits, and some of them were like really recent, you know, with like, this photo makes me sick. But we're actually serious about raising kids, and in fact, we've built on our campus one of the very first on-site company daycare centers in the United States, and visitors to our headquarters, and I know there's a few people in the audience who have been out to visit us. When you're there, visitors often comment that the place feels like a family. And well, that's because it is a family. And we have mothers and fathers taking their kids to visit them at their desks, or taking a few minutes off to drop by the daycare to visit their children. And we actually don't call it daycare, we call it child development center, because it's not a babysitting facility, but in fact, it's one of the most advanced young children emotional and educational development centers in the entire United States. So it's one of the reasons that we're consistently rated among the best companies for women. And in fact, we've been called the coolest company on the planet. So, you know, how does that happen? How do you go about creating the coolest company in the world? Well, let's start with our history, beginning with the fact that, you know, especially in the early days, we were the people that we made our clothes for. So we were skiers and surfers and climbers. You know, we were our own customers, and to a very large extent, we still are, including Yvonne and me, who go back a long ways as climbing partners. And we got a lot of adventures under our belts, like this one in Alaska after a successful climb of Denali, the highest mountain in North America. And I'll just say that there's a lot more than alcohol involved in the photograph, and leave it at that. But Yvonne and I climbed in a lot of places, and that includes Patagonia, the place, where in the late 60s, Yvonne made what back then was only the third ascent of Fitzroy, one of the most emblematic peaks in southern South America, and that's that high peak on the skyline. He did that with his climbing partner and my very close friend, Doug Tompkins, who founded the North Face, went on to found Esprit. And for both those guys, this was the most influential trip in their lives. And I'll let Yvonne explain it himself in this clip from the film that I produced called 180 South.
I picked up a 16mm Bolex camera to record the trip. Loaded the car up with surfboards and climbing gear and took off for a 10,000-mile trip down south.
I think from the time we decided to go, it was like 2 weeks before we went. We bought this old van and took off from Ventura. 1968, you gotta remember the Pan American Highway was pretty wild. It was dirt road from Mexico City all the way south. It was like being in Montana or Wyoming 100 years ago. Here we're in an area that's the size of the whole American West, with no people.
For those of us that grew up going out into the wilds of the world, where nature was basically untouched, we got into our souls a sense of beauty.
That trip had a big influence on both Doug and I. It kind of set the course for what we're going to do later in life.
For me, it was the best trip of my life.
So, after Yvonne returned from Patagonia is when he started to sell those few items of clothing made for climbers, and in 1973, he decided to spin that part of the business off, and this was only 5 years after that climb of Fitzroy, and that's where the inspiration came from to call the clothing business Patagonia, and that's where the logo came from. That highest point on the skyline on your jackets is Fitzroy. So sports like climbing and skiing and surfing, they are the foundation of the company. And it is our direct experiences from those sports that in turn is the direct inspiration for our commitment to environmental protection. When Yvonne climbed Fitzroy back in the 60s, it was surrounded, just like he said, by complete wilderness. And then when he and I went back to the exact same place, only 20 years later, we saw the developers had erected the street signs and laid out the grid for what today is the small city of Chaltén, out where formerly there was absolutely nothing. You know, or seeing firsthand the effects of continued clear-cutting on the beech forest in Patagonia that are going to take generations to regrow if they ever do. And down in Patagonia as well as in many other places in the world, we've seen the effects of overgrazing that's led to erosion and with our own eyes, grasslands turning into deserts. We've seen in our own lifetimes the glaciers begin to recede and in some cases completely disappear as the planet's warm because of greenhouse gases emissions. And when you see things like this, we are morally obligated to do something about it. And for those of us in business, we have to ask ourselves how we can use our business as a tool for environmental protection. So that's what we did. And by the early 1990s, we had codified this commitment into a mission statement that starts with making the best product we can. Because durable products that are used and reused year after year have by far the lowest environmental impact. But in addition to durability, the next part of our mission is to make the best product, but do it causing no unnecessary harm. And the last part of the mission is to use the business to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis. A complex mission for a complex world. So let's go now back to the first part of that mission, building the best product, because in addition to lowering a product's footprint, like I just explained, durability is obviously pretty important if you're climbing a big wall in the Himalayas where the quality of your jacket can literally make the difference of whether you survive or not. But it's the same if you're a big wave surfer in cold water, like you see here with our surfing ambassador, Ramon Navarro, at his home break down in Chile. And Ramon expects us not only to make him the very best wetsuit anybody can get, but to make it causing no unnecessary harm. Now, notice that I didn't say cause the least harm, but saying no unnecessary harm implies that there is harm in making products. And for us, that's the core recognition of how we define sustainability, by acknowledging that the manufacture of all stuff has its impact on the planet. And our role, consequently, is to strive to cause no unnecessary harm in that product. And in the case of Ramon's wetsuits, that means replacing the component of the fabric that was made with traditional neoprene, which in turn is made from petroleum, with rubber from rubber trees that reduce the greenhouse gas emissions in the entire process by about 80%. We've measured it really carefully. And then we've also paid close attention to where the rubber trees are in Guatemala, where the locals have been tapping the trees for about 75 years now. And the plantations are certified by the Forest Stewardship Council. But we didn't want to just take the certification as the validation. So we sent our own team down there, including Ramon himself, to Guatemala to work with the workers and to talk to them and to work with biologists and to assess the health of the forests and confirm the safeguarding of biodiversity. So as much as possible, what this really means is that in business, if you really want to cause no unnecessary harm, you've got to know your supply chain. And you got to know it all the way to the trees. It's the same with our down products, where we've traced every single feather to all the farms raising the geese to make sure they're neither force feeding nor live plucking the geese. And this includes going all the way to the parent farms of the geese themselves. And you can see in this illustration that that's pretty complex endeavor. This is a screen grab from a video that we made, if you want to check it out more, called What the Pluck. But knowing your supply chain and managing it directly, that's the only way to make sure that our down products are causing no unnecessary harm, including no unnecessary harm to the geese. So let's go to the third part of that mission, to use our business to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis. And one of the ways we do that is, curiously enough perhaps, supporting civil society, all of us, to be more environmentally responsible. And with this goal, our main initiative is called 1% for the Planet. And this is a program where we donate 1% of our sales to environmental protection. And I said sales, not profits. But whether we're having a good year or a bad year, or rain or shine, that money comes right off the top into a fund that then is distributed to environmental groups around the world. And this year, with that Black Friday event that Scott mentioned at the beginning, where for one day we decided instead of giving 1%, we're going to give 100% of everything we make around the world back to environmental groups, that this year we're going to end up giving away about $17 million. And that will be to well over 800 environmental organizations who are in the most part smaller grassroots groups with volunteers such as these guys trying to save the Colorado River. And how can you not give a grant to these guys? So trying to protect rivers was really the origin of the support for us of activists and activism. It actually is the very beginning of our whole commitment to philanthropy, and I'm going to let Yvonne tell that story himself in this next film clip.
In the 70s, the city wanted to channelize the Ventura River, and there was a city council meeting, and so we decided to all go because we were concerned that it was going to hurt the sand flow. And so we showed up, and there were all these scientists there saying, it's not going to hurt the river because it's a dead river, so just forget about it. And at the end of the talk, a young grad student got up and showed a slideshow of all the life along the river, all the eels and the birds that nest along the river and the raccoons. There was still 50 steelhead that go up that polluted river, and it wasn't dead at all. And that brought the house down, and it showed me what one individual can do, the power of one individual. That led to us starting a Friends of the Ventura River, and now we're working on trying to take out a dam upstream that is preventing the steelhead from going up into one of the tributaries. I really like the idea of taking out no longer useful dams. When you take out a dam, that's a real victory. I mean, a concrete victory, so to speak. It's gone. And then that allows fish to migrate up. It stops the water from heating up. people built those dams and people have the responsibility to take them down. I think all of us are responsible for doing something. I mean, if you can, you're a good speaker, you should get out and speak about the injustices of the world. You know, if you're a good writer, write about it. If you have nothing but free time, you should volunteer for good causes. To do good, you actually have to do something.
So we started a campaign and made a film called Damnation to support the removal of old and useless, what we call deadbeat dams, and also to get people to oppose new dams when there were alternatives. And there often, in fact, most commonly are. And this included a major hydro project down in Chile, in Patagonia. And it had been planned for this river you see here, the Bacher, the largest free-flowing river remaining in the entire country. And we drummed up all of our opposition to this. And we worked with the NGOs in Chile, and it resulted in the biggest civil society protest in the country's history, 100,000 people marching, and the president killed the whole project, total victory. So it might seem unusual for an apparel company to be focused on something like dam removal, but that's what happens when you have a privately held company and it's owned by a fly fisherman who has a different definition of who the real shareholders of the company are, as we explained in this ad, where we said that without a healthy planet, there aren't going to be any shareholders. So let's go back again to that mission statement. Again, to use the business to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis, and look at another way we do that, which is extending our brand and with it all the values that we have into other sectors. So just three years ago, we launched a brand extension into food called Patagonia Provisions. And we're doing it because we realize that the footprint on the planet of food, as most of you in the room know, is enormous. It's bigger than any of the consumer product categories, and consequently the promise of food to reduce our human footprint is also equally huge. So currently we have a line of fruit bars and dried soups and bison jerky and a cold smoked salmon product that all have ingredients that in some cases go beyond just being sustainable and into agriculture and grazing practices that are called regenerative, and that here at Iowa State in your own Leopold Center on campus here are some of the leading thinkers in the world developing these ideas. But in the case of our bison, the meat is all sourced from a large ranch in South Dakota that's owned by Dan O'Brien, who's a well-known author and novelist and rancher. And he manages the bison so that they rotate between large paddocks that end up replicating the way bison once roamed free across the Great Plains. And that in turn allows the native grasses to maximize soil health. And that in turn begins to pull carbon out of the air, and it puts it back in the ground. And we've measured the amount going back into the ground over traditional practices. It is enormous. It's about 4 tons per acre per year. And in farming, it can be just the same. So last year, we launched another new product called Longroot Ale. Yeah, Patagonia is now in the beer business. And the beer's made from, and we're all stoked about that. You can imagine a bunch of surfers that making clothes or, you know, besides themselves, the company's now making beer. And it's made from a perennial grass called Kernza that's grown in fields using these regenerative farming protocols. And the protocols for us really start with organic farming and then add to that protocols of no-tilling and cover and rotational cropping and composting so that root systems go down into the soil 10 and 15 feet and more, as you can see in this photograph of a regenerative Kernza wheat alongside traditional wheat grown with conventional practices. So the result's the same in the bison grasslands, healthy soil that not only retains more water and in times of drought increases productivity, but pulls huge amounts of carbon out of the air. And to the extent that scientists are beginning to extrapolate these few places around the world in different climates and different soil types that are farming and grazing animals in this way, and extrapolating those proof of concepts is just an astounding arithmetic that suggests that if we were to scale this to somewhere between 20 and 30 or 40% of farming and grazing on planet Earth, we could pull so much carbon out of the air, it could get us down close to pre-industrial revolution atmospheric parts per million. 290 parts per million, to be specifically. So back to our mission. That was one way we're doing it. And another way is by inspiring other businesses to be more sustainable. And an interesting and kind of entertaining example of that is an initiative that started in 2009 with the very unlikely odd coupling of Walmart and Patagonia. And we invited them to partner with us to create a coalition of apparel and footwear companies committed to sustainability. And I met personally with several high-level Walmart executives, and I told them that we would codename the effort David and Goliath. And they said, you know, okay. And then they said, you know, we got to talk about this. So they went off and did a side huddle, and they came back in a minute, and they said, you know, we got a problem. And I went, oh, God, here the whole idea is going south before it can even go one step north. And they said, the condition is that you're Goliath and we're David. And I said, listen, whatever. We just got to make this thing work. So we launched it just 6 years ago with a letter that we sent out to the CEOs of a dozen other companies inviting them to attend a meeting. And let me read from the letter. Quote, we expect to achieve consensus on the need for a universally accepted approach for measuring apparel sector sustainability and to establish a strategy for ongoing collaboration to create and implement that standard. And one executive later told me that, you know, when you get a letter with the logos of Walmart and Patagonia side by side, it is so bizarre that you don't throw it away and you do it. So they did it, and we called it the Sustainable Apparel Coalition. And today it represents 200 members with companies that are suppliers and brands and retailers, and there's also NGOs and universities and government agencies. In its entirety, the group represents over 40% of the entire global market now for apparel and footwear. And we've created a set of tools called the HIG Index that measures and manages sustainability impacts. And this HIG is actually not a single tool, but it's a set of tools that are designed for different people and companies to measure different impacts and that way, with better information, to make better decisions. So product and supply chain managers can measure their facilities in the supply chain. Brands can measure themselves and get instant benchmarks to see where they are against their competitors. And designers can see the environmental impact of choices like materials in real time just by clicking on different choices. We've got another tool in development right now that's going to measure both the environmental and social labor footprints of finished products. And when that's done, about 18 months out from now, then we set the stage for making the HIG a consumer-facing number that people can use their devices to scan in stores on the product and give them deep information. You could be there all day going into the supply chain of whatever you're interested in. So another way that we are working to help our customers to live more responsibly is another initiative that Scott mentioned at the beginning, Warnware, that I helped create, where our customers have the option of sending us broken products to repair. And our repair center, which is the largest apparel repair center in North America, and I think maybe even the world, will fix our customer stuff and get it back to them. And we also encourage our customers to resell the gear if they aren't using it. And in fact, in just a couple months, we're going to be launching a program to take back from our customers used stuff they're not using anymore in our stores, give them credit in return, repair and clean, and then resell on our website. That'll launch in summer. Warmwear.com is going to, we're going to go into the used clothing business big time. The fourth R, or the third R, is recycle, of course. So for many years, we've had a program trying to encourage our customers and you guys to bring your truly worn-out stuff back to us, and we'll use the best technology available, depending on the material of construction, to recycle it, preferably into a closed-loop system. And we're getting good at that, too. But the fourth R, and by far the most controversial one of all, is reduce. You can imagine why that one's controversial for a business. But we didn't want to shy away from it. It's a hard topic. And to get that conversation started a few years ago, we ran this ad on Black Friday, full page in the New York Times, with that bold headline, "Don't Buy This Jacket." And we wanted the headline to stop people in their tracks on the biggest shopping frenzy day of the year, so that they read the copy, because there we told them that no matter how hard we had tried to make this best-selling jacket with no unnecessary harm, well, guess what? It had used 135 liters of water to produce it. It had emitted 20 pounds of CO2 gases. It had left behind 2/3 of its own weight in waste. It's like I told you a little bit ago. We wanted to explain to everybody that all stuff has its footprint. And we wanted to remind not only our customers, but everybody, that all of our actions as consumers have these hidden numbers inside of them. And as a result of this annual compounded consumption on the planet, the results are the statistics that we all see every day, the hockey stick carbon dioxide emissions, the increasing rising temperatures around the world, the rising sea levels. And all of us know about the continued surge in global energy consumption that's going to continue to track greenhouse gas emissions until more renewables go online. And some of you have probably seen the increase in the global use of pesticides and insecticides and fertilizers. That's really close to all of your hearts here in your state. And I think all of us are obligated to ask why kids today are born with over 200 chemicals in their bloods that aren't naturally there, and why over 80% of our forests are gone, which is part of the reason for wild plant and animals going extinct at rates that's estimated to be over 1,000 times the normal rate. So at our company at Patagonia, we consider these indicators of the planet's health to be our KPIs. In business school, all you guys here in the School of Business know that's key performance indicators, and you know how companies use these numbers to manage their business. Well, for us, the ultimate KPIs are the ones I just showed you. And by every measure, they're all going the wrong direction. And by every measure, we've still got so much work to do. Because by every measure, we're exceeding the carrying capacity of the planet on a planetary basis, where every year we human beings are using what's now estimated to be 1.5 times the amount of resources that the planet can annually replenish or restore. And on a per capita basis here in this country, it's 7 Earths. And not to criticize anybody, or to call out all of you in the College of Business, but you don't need an MBA to know that long-term, that is not sustainable. And we're digging into the weeds on things like this too, where we're starting to realize that all these sustainability innovations, including the ones that we come up with that lower our footprint on a product basis, as long as everything keeps growing the way it is, it offsets any of those innovations. And it's going to prevent us from getting back to achieving true sustainability. The only way we feel we're really going to be able to do that is adjusting our business models to accommodate what we consider to be out there on the horizon line, the inevitable reduction in global consumption. So I think all of us have to remember that whether it's through our roles as citizens or as business people, that we're all living. We're all heading to the same place because we're all living on the same place. And that place is, of course, our one and only home planet right here. So for all of my colleagues at Patagonia, I again want to really thank all of you for bringing me here this evening to my now new favorite state of Iowa. It's been a great pleasure. Thanks so much. And we still have a lot of time for questions and answers. There's mics on each side of the stage. And as those of you are walking up to the mics to ask your questions, I'll tell you about another experience I had today on campus here with your president, Leith, when I was in his office and we were chatting you know, about some of the things I've shared with you this evening. And I shared with him an idea, a thought I've had recently that all of you in the room here in school about to head out into the large world and make your own place there. You know, there's two things that you can do. And one of them is something that all of us in the room can do. And that is to just buy stuff and services from companies that are committed to stakeholder and not shareholder value and return. And there's a growing number of companies out there. It's not just us. They're growing by the dozens. And support them. And insist that all of them be transparent at the same time. That's an enormous lever. All of us can pull that one. But the other one you guys can pull that are leaving school right now is to refuse to work for any companies that aren't doing that. Just tell them no. And that's so hard to do when you're starting your career. It's hard to do at any point in your career when sometimes you might have to make career trade-offs and perhaps not accept something that you otherwise might. But think it through, and I bet long-term you'll all discover that's the right decision to make. And without any doubt, you'll discover collectively that you've got the most power in your hands in the world right now to change the world. And I really mean that. Sincerely, you do. The influence you have on companies is incredible. And I tell you, the heads of those companies, and I talk to these guys and women, they're waking up really fast. And they're knowing, they're getting this sense that you're not going to want to work for them. The best and the brightest coming out of our schools are only going to work for the companies that want to make a better world for all of us. So, come on, somebody's got questions. Here we go.
So first, I've been a huge fan of Patagonia ever since you guys started making fishing gear. And Don't Buy This Jacket campaign only reinforced that. I have two questions. First, when you call out in your mission statement the words environmental crisis, that can be a trigger word for certain tribes in the current U.S. market, a negative trigger word. Have you quantified any sort of market loss that Patagonia has encountered by taking such a bold stance on environmental sustainability? And then second question is, do you have any lessons for publicly traded companies? Because being privately held can give you the flexibility that maybe publicly traded corporations don't have.
Well, thank you. On the first question, it took 2 years, and not just our work, but a lot of outsiders, some real philosophers to come in and work with us from 1991 to clear into 93 to come up with the mission statement. And there was many versions of it. And finally, everyone aligned on using that word crisis, when everyone realized that's exactly what we're heading into. And to call it anything less than what it is alternating the facts. And we're not going to do that. We'll never do that. There are no alternate facts. And the second question, if customers don't want to buy our stuff because we're supporting the environmental crisis, they should go buy somebody else's clothes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think you got there first, so then I'm going to go over there.
Thanks, sir.
Sure.
So I appreciate what your company does, and I actually work for REI, so you know we're kind of like hand in hand with trying to save the world. But lately, I've been kind of having a crisis of conscience because I'm also a snowboarder, also a climber, and I've noticed lately that the mountains have gotten a lot more crowded. How do we reconcile our desire for conservation and preservation while at the same time expanding the sports?
Yeah, that's a dilemma. On a personal level, you probably got to burn some carbon and go somewhere where there aren't any other people. And that's getting increasingly hard to do. But all those people out there are arguably converts or on some path towards, and that's a loaded term and it's a kind of tribal and it has a religious connotation. But yet, what I'm talking about, of course, is people that are being exposed to the natural world. And through that exposure, we hope will come to love the natural world. Underscoring, of course, the truth that we all know that nobody can protect anything that they don't really love. So for us, the increasing numbers are, you know, the lift is hard to stand a longer lift line, but there's a really important upside to that, and that's how we see it. And we try to go out into the wildest parts of the world. They're getting harder to find. And what was the second question?
Oh, there wasn't one. Okay. I mean, but do we play less? Now, knowing what we know, knowing what our environmental impact is?
No, we get out more. Yeah, just increase your passions. Stoke the fire.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. I love REI, too. You guys have been partners right from the beginning. Our biggest customer. Sir.
Thank you for being here. I'm an MIS major. And I was just wondering if you had any advice going back on working for companies that you think are making the right change for the environment. I was wondering if you had any advice for those of us who are in fields where we may be doing stuff that's a little bit harder to quantify our direct impact on the environment, because especially in like computer technology, you know, you could be working for firms where you're doing stuff that it's kind of hard to see exactly where the impacts are.
Yeah, that's such a tough question. I can't provide a meaningful answer, but I could. That's not true. Maybe what I'm about to say will have meaning. A practical answer is tough. But at a higher level, I was explaining this to some of your colleagues earlier this afternoon, that one of the principles we have at Patagonia is a paraphrase of Plato's suggestion to live and examine life. I was telling my colleague Fred down here, who runs the Leopold Institute, that for us, that means that we must always ask more and more questions, to always dig deeper and deeper, to always finally try to find the headwaters of our impact. And it's such a difficult thing to do. I mean, we got into organic cotton because Yvonne walked into one of the stores way back in the day and it smelled weird. And he asked what the smell was. And nobody knew. And then he goes, you know, we got to find out. So people started asking more and more questions. We eventually found out it was formaldehyde being off-gassed from clothes that were being unbagged. And then he said, where's that coming from? So everybody started checking into it more. And eventually it led to traditionally grown cotton protocols. That was like where it landed. And then we started digging into what those were and what we could learn about what the impacts from traditional cotton farming were on the planet and the communities and the biosphere eventually. And as the years went by, I mean, of intense scrutiny and digging, finally we got to a point where in the mid-1990s, early 90s, we started introducing organically grown cotton into the line. And by 1995 or 6, we realized that we were still causing more harm than could possibly justify with the amount of regular cotton we were still using. So we converted to 100% organically grown cotton without enough organic cotton in the entire marketplace when we did that commitment to make even our own clothes. And what happened? Well, the sales dropped off like 20%. I mean, it was a crisis time. And then we had to go out and work with farmers. We had to learn how to cotton farm and how to farm organically. And we had a whole team that started teaching themselves how to do it. And then we had to fund teams to go around and train farmers. I'm getting off topic a little bit, but yet on topic, behind it all, is this idea of continually asking the harder and hard questions until you get right down to the source of it. And then you feel like you finally understand all of it. You never will understand all of it, but that's my advice to you. That commitment to lead and examine life has really served our company really well. It has provided tremendous business value to Patagonia. And guess what? It is an equally valid way to live your life.
Thank you very much.
Hi. When Patagonia creates their own tensile lyocell fibers or figures out how to recycle water bottles into your fleece, is there a separate branch that researches that, or how does that process work?
Yeah, well, that's done by a number of teams. We have some of our what are called our production team that work directly with our supply chain partners. We have a very robust group of men and women at Patagonia on our materials team. For a company our size, it's pretty astounding. There's a dozen people, half of them with PhDs, who just focus on materials and materials science. We have a fabric testing lab that is pretty big, again, for a small-sized company, medium-sized company. But the answer to your question is that we can't do it by ourselves. That we have to do it in partnership with suppliers. And all the examples that you just mentioned were developed that way. With our polyester supplier to find ways to make polyester from recycled materials that equal the quality of the fiber made from virgin petroleum. And then we've worked with other suppliers to take it to another level and develop technologies to actually recycle polyester clothes chemically back into virgin fiber. And now that's been done, which is, by the way, a true closed loop. And then we've measured that very carefully. That process results in a 75% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions and a 70% reduction in overall energy use. And it costs a lot more, so it's not scaling past the ability that we have right now. And I'd be up here all night going off into these tangents, but the reason it's not scaling is because the price of petroleum is too low. And petroleum's too low because of fracking. Well, we'll just leave it there because we'd be down in the weeds on that one. But you get the idea. Anyway, we can't do it by ourselves. And we have to find partners who will partner with us. And they get a lot of glow from this. It works for them from a business perspective, because when we go to market and our customers support us with these new materials, then we never take an exclusive other than just a few months to get it kickstarted. And then we make sure we have deals with these guys to allow them to sell to our competitors. And oftentimes, sometimes we give away our IP right at the beginning with the wetsuit technology. We didn't want to keep it. We offered it to the full surf industry, saying it's yours, like Elon Musk did with some of Tesla's technology. That's a good strategy, too. Over here.
I'm an independent agronomist, and I'm glad you talked about food production in the world. Last year, there was a longtime international agricultural development specialist who spoke here, and according to him, he works at Food at First right now. According to him, there's enough food being produced in the world today to give every man, woman, and child 1.5 times the amount of food that they need to eat. But yet, we always hear from large businesses, agribusinesses, and food companies that we got to produce more food, we got to produce more food because we got to feed 9 billion people in the next several years. But we already have enough to feed over 10 billion people currently today. So it's not a food production problem. These companies are awash with money and they need to continue their investment strength somewhere or another. So we tear down rainforests in Southeast Asia, Central and South America to produce more food that really isn't needed. We need to distribute it differently. What can you do as a company to elevate this myth and bring it out into the light?
Yeah, well, we're trying to promote these this idea of the benefits of regenerative agriculture and grazing. You know, with all of our communication tools that we have, and they're pretty robust. We're a skilled marketing company, and we are producing films, we are writing essays, we're publishing articles, we're supporting a number of NGOs that are working in this space, as well as developing our own products and holding them up. And we're going deep on this. It is, I might say, probably our foremost environmental initiative measured by the importance that we apply to it when we look out on the horizon line. We are thinking that out there on that horizon line is an inflection point where Patagonia will be selling a lot more food than it does clothes. That's actually our goal. And the reason we want to do that has nothing to do with food quantity, but everything to do with soil health, as I explained. Our idea is to apply the same mission statement with which we make apparel that was the frame for my presentation this evening to food as we have successfully to apparel, and by that example to inspire others to do the same. So we're committed, and we're going to do everything we can to get that message out. I might also add that I was a little cautious getting up here in front of all of you and talking about our food division and explaining these farming and ranching protocols to an audience who is, in many cases, even probably most of you, all of you who came from far, so much more experienced than I am or that we are. So we also want to come into this humbly. We want to come in willing to learn, you know, everything we can and have open minds. And so that's our commitment to food. That's why we're doing it. We're doing it because of the mission statement.
I just have one more question.
Sure.
I know your Warnwear team traveled together and they took that van and set up their sewing machines for everyone. Is that a common occurrence for branches of Patagonia to kind of travel together and on different projects and stuff?
Hey, you looking for a job? Is that what you're No, we, yeah, we, well, yeah, we're a close family. So we're always out quite a bit together. But the Warnwear truck, we've got this old converted truck that runs on biodiesel. It goes from coast to coast. It starts on one coast, goes to the other, takes a little bit of time off and turns around, comes back. And it's starting another tour in two more weeks all over the country. And we set up shop on campuses. And for a full day, we fix people's broken clothes, not just ours, anybody's. And then at some of those events this spring, I'm going to go to the campus and give a talk similar to the one that you saw here, modified a little bit. Another friend of mine, Adam Warbach, who is a conservationist, is also going to give a talk. And in combination, we're calling our talk, and this perhaps sounds presumptuous, but we put a lot of thought into it. We're calling the talk after one of my favorite W.S. Merwin poems. It's titled, What to Do and How to Live. And it is so many of the things we've been talking about this evening that I've been sharing with all of you. As you leave school and move into the world, you know, what are you going to do and how are you going to live? And as a company, we're intrigued and willing to tackle that one and do what we can to add ideas. There was an earlier question, too, that I failed to answer completely. I just remembered that one of the other young women at the mic asked if there are any other big companies out there that are doing any of what we're doing. And I do work closely with Unilever. And my colleague, Fred, here with the Leopold Center, Fred and I are on a small council that advises the president of their North American business. And I also work pretty closely with the global CEO, Paul Polman, out of the company's headquarters in London. Paul and I, in fact, go around giving talks together sometimes. And I must say that of all the big multinationals, they are far and away making the biggest commitment to sustainability and transparency. They like to hold up the fact that of their portfolio of brands, the ones that are most committed to sustainability are the ones that are outperforming all of the cohorts in their mix by between 20% and 30% in the case of every so-called sustainability brand. And other multinationals are taking note of that, as they are of the fact that since Paul took the reins at Unilever, the stock price has gone up 160%, in large part because of those sustainability commitments. So more than any company, they are demonstrating to the large businesses of the world that that this sustainability commitments are creating business value. It's undeniable. It is self-evident, and it's getting stronger. It's getting stronger because of many drivers. I mean, companies like Walmart and Unilever can save money by managing the energy inputs in their supply chain. That's pretty obvious. A company like Unilever can enjoy brand benefits. Pretty obvious. They can manage their risks in the supply chain, especially where if you're managing for sustainability, you're arguably managing time bombs that may be embedded in your supply chain you otherwise wouldn't even know about. But interestingly enough, there's other things starting to emerge right now. Why is Unilever stock going up? Well, in the main, it's because equity fund managers are starting to use sustainability as screens of where they place their bets. And Unilever's measuring really high. So that's an enormous driver. The one I mentioned to you guys earlier is also increasingly a big one, and I think the biggest one. And that's right here. It's all of you going out into the workplace. Who are you going to work with? You have so much power in your hands. And ultimately, that power is going to be delivered to consumers. I'm confident of that. I think as all of us become increasingly aware of our human activity on our one and only planet, we're all going to increasingly want to align with companies that make these commitments through our voting with our wallet on the products and services that we support. So that was the answer to that other question that I had earlier. Sorry, I didn't get to it early.
All right, so I'd just like to ask you to elaborate on your the status of, I guess, the classification of Patagonia as a company. From what I understand, you're classified as a B corporation. Is that right?
Yes,
yeah.
We are.
Yeah, so I've been following things like that for the last few years and kind of watching what, you know, where I buy products that I need. So could you elaborate on the B Corporation and if there's any resources to where we could really, you know, look to see what we're buying in more mm-hmm. depth?
Yeah, the B Corp movement started about 12, 14 years ago by a couple of guys who sold their company. They had a business making basketball clothes. And they took all the money they made, and instead of, you know, buying the yacht and the mansion, they put it all into this idea they had to create a foundation and an NGO that would certify companies for their what's called triple bottom line commitments, for their commitments to community, their commitments to their own workers, their commitments to environmental impact, their commitments to social justice throughout their supply chain. Myriad measurements like this that were all above and beyond delivering value to shareholders. And they called it the B Corp, and they developed a certification that we participated in. We helped them make this tool over the years. We road tested it, as it were. But we still didn't become a B Corporation because we didn't need that B Corp certification next to us, because our customers already knew that that's what we did. And young companies getting into business, though, really valued it, and it started to grow and scale. But then about 3 or 4 years ago, something really interesting happened. States started to pass legislation to allow companies to become official B Corps. And what that meant was they were, in those states, allowed to recharter their organizations to deliver value to stakeholders and not just shareholders. And that was a big opportunity for us. And we took it. We became the first B Corp in California. And that allowed us to recharter our company. It allowed us to rewrite our articles of incorporation that previously had been legally required to mandate us just to deliver value to shareholders, as all companies are mandated to do, and all boards of directors have the fiduciary responsibility to deliver. And if there are a B Corp in a state that has passed this legislation, the board can manage those companies towards those shared values, and that's just what we did. So now our articles start with our commitment to make the best product with no unnecessary harm. That includes our commitment to give 1% of our sales forevermore to environmental NGOs. It includes our commitment to deep transparency. We are obligated as a company now to expose anything we discover that's harmful. We got to tell people right away, because that's the way we're incorporated. We have to provide daycare to all of our employees. We have to support women with maternity leave and fathers with paternity leave. It's all in our charter. That's why we became a B Corp. It's a terrific movement. It's hockey sticking. Started just a few years ago. There's now thousands of companies around the world that have become B Corps, so we are in firm support of the effort. Are we at time?
We are at time.
Thank you very much. I do want to let you know, if you have a few questions that are lingering, we are going to have a reception over here to my right, your left. So he'll be over here for a few minutes to talk a little bit more, answer some questions that you've got. We've got a book table set up over here. We've got some copies of some of his books. But let's have one more round of applause for Rick. Thank him for his time.